Welcome to Behind the Screens. We're here today to talk about the multiple Oscar nominee, Mank. I'm here with the team that brought that incredible design to the film. It's Oscar nominee production designer, Donald Graham Burt, and set decorator, Jan Pascale. Thanks so much for being a part of this. But to give folks a taste of what it is, or I'm sorry, a look, forgive the imprecision of the metaphor, of what we're talking about here, let's take a look at a clip from Mank that illustrates why you guys have received the accolades you have for it.
What a year you have, dude. None of you weather, despite everything. Your MGM ship, I'm happy to say, is full steam ahead. We're on track this recent slate for our most successful year ever.
Well, that's great news.
Would you like to go to a bungalow and lay down?
I think I'd rather stay upright.
Perhaps we could find you a costume.
Well, why would I need a costume? Hello, everyone. Better late than ever.
Mank, where's Sarah?
Caring for Clan Mankiewicz.
What train did you take?
Glendale. I missed my stop. Got a taxi from Morro Bay.
I'm confused. I thought the invitation called for circus attire, not flea circus.
I was cornered by a man who sold vacuum cleaners. A show of hands.
Sir?
Who knows what a vacuum cleaner is?
Martin, would you set a place for Mr. Mankiewicz somewhere where he might get some air?
Would you follow me this way, sir?
And offer him some coffee.
Yeah, Mr. Mankiewicz could use some coffee.
And how's Marie Antoinette coming, I guess?
Previews have been a struggle for general audiences. We made some transfers,
but I should have known. Versailles, all those costumes and wigs. You can't tell those stories without overhauling them for a modern audience.
And how's the performance of your leading lady? The picture depends upon her.
Norma put her heart and soul into it. I should have insisted she take some time. It's a lot to deal with a loss like that.
Marion would have made it her own.
Marion would have been perfection.
Marion Antoinette.
It was Irving's picture. It takes kind of
Marionette.
I'm not interested in educating our customers. You want to send a message? Call Western Union.
Literary picture.
Let them get cake. Who needs to see that?
Guys, there's so much to talk about in that scene alone, because what you have, or what you did so incredibly well, is to sort of like make these visual references to Citizen Kane and the sets, and also to give this thing its own life and to give some sense of how Mankiewicz basically inhabits the screen. We're watching him being shuffled off to Siberia, and then you've got to find ways to build that out. So talk about that a little bit.
Well, I think the challenge for us was putting together San Simeon, you know, and because we couldn't film there. So, you know, what we wanted to do was emulate it, because we couldn't really, you know, trying to replicate San Simeon, going to what they call Hearst Castle now. And when you look at the current reference of it, it's so detailed, and there's so many layers to it. And there was just no way we were going to be able to do that. So, I mean, I think, you know, we approached the whole film as its own film. We weren't trying to make Citizen Kane. And I think that bled over into so many things. It bled over in how we approached San Simeon. You know, we weren't trying to replicate Hearst Castle. We were trying to make something that emulated it, that represented the opulence and the indulgence of William Hearst. We brought in elements from it, but at the same time, we weren't trying to be so exacting that it wasn't a game of like, let's fool the audience. It was, you know, this is for our story. This is what we're trying to tell. And I think from the beginning, the approach always was that, you know, Mank is a separate film from Citizen Kane. And, you know, there were some references that we made to it. We paid homage to certain things. In the scene where he's at the North Verde Ranch and he drops the liquor bottle on the floor, the hallway when they exit right after this scene and they walk out, we we built in the infinity mirrors down the hallway. But it was sort of an issue of, in speaking with the DP and with David, like, well, if we see them and it works, fine. If it doesn't, we know they're there. And it was sort of like, let's just take an element from what they did physically in Citizen Kane and pay homage to it and put it within our set. So I think first and foremost, it's important to realize that this was a separate film. And the way it was described to me in the beginning from David was always that, you know, he would be down in a film vault and he'd be going along and looking at films and he'd see Citizen Kane and he'd pull it out and look at it. And next to it would be this film entitled Mank. And he would pull it out and go, oh, Mank, I didn't realize that. And it, you know, it wanted more than anything to feel like it was made at the same time period. And I think that's where it reflects Citizen Kane, is that it was made, it wanted to feel like a film that was made in the 30s and 40s. And that was sort of the mandate that resonated with me throughout the making of the whole film, because when he and I had that conversation, it was a good 3 or 4 months before, you know, even went into production.
Yeah, Jan, I'm going to get you to weigh on this too, just because I think as much as anything, I'm aware of like the weight of the objects in this. Yeah. Like I'm waiting to see when he puts the fork down and reaches for the knife to tap the side of the glass with. I mean, there's this thing, the elements feel tactile in a way they often don't in movies.
Well, thank you. That's a great compliment. We really tried hard to, as Don was saying, to give the essence of San Simeon and translate the richness that was there. So we actually did make an effort, my assistant Joni and I, to get the exact plates that Hearst had, which were the blue willow plates with a scalloped gold edge, which we bought, you know, almost one at a time on eBay. and we tried to match the glassware between us and our prop master, Trish Gallagher Glenn. We tried to get as close to vintage looking glassware as we could. And, you know, we had beeswax candles that were hand rolled and tapestries that fit the era, but didn't look tattered, which was a challenge to get 13-foot tapestries that looked brand new. And we recreated the tables that matched we matched the grain from the real tables at Hearst Castle. And we got really close on the chairs that he had, the fabric. And so we wanted to really capture those big elements. And then the rest of it fell into the world that Don created in the room with all the beautiful architecture. So it was a challenge for sure, but it was a joyful result.
Yeah, with all the San Simeon work, it was really, we sat down with the research and we sort of discerned which elements were important. And we said, okay, what takes prominence here in looking at the research? And we sort of, you know, in the dining hall, it was about the long table, the chairs, the tapestries and the side tables. And then everything else we sort of brought in on our own.
I guess I was thinking because each section feels like a different movie of the era. I mean, I think when we meet him in Victorville, I mean, we're aware of the light coming in through those blinds. And it feels almost like a film noir in some ways. And so often in these rooms, we get a sense of him being kind of trapped. He's in the middle of the frame and surrounded by things. And which is kind of the state he's in emotionally anyway. You know, he's trapped in this legend he's made for himself and as he go forward. And clearly you guys found a way in visual terms to render that so often. Just you brought that up a little bit earlier, Don, but if you would, the two of you talk about that early scene in Victorville at the ranch where we were aware of how he seems almost too big for that room in some ways.
Right. Well, the thing about the ranch was that it wanted to contrast, you know, so much San Simeon. He wanted to feel sequestered. He wanted to feel that he was in this dusty, desolate area, and hence the light coming in from the outside. It was, you know, he was in the middle of the desert, and there would always be light out there blasting in, or the presence of light, which sort of translates into that noir feeling you're talking about, as opposed to San Simeon, which is sort of an encased tomb, kind of like a castle, where all the light is emitted from the practicals and the candles and the torches that we brought in. So, you know, there was that contrast that we wanted to get between those two spaces, you know. And, you know, the thing about the space at the North Verde Ranch was that, you know, from the beginning, it's sort of, it's like the spine of the movie. We keep going back to it. And from the beginning, David and I had conversations about the fact that, you know, we didn't want it to be a room with just a bed in it. That became so boring and just so locked down that, you know, you got tired of coming back and seeing this person in a bed against the same walls. So he and I scouted the location early on, and we sort of went through and harvested visual information from different spaces within the existing location, which, by the way, still exists. The ranch is still there, and we filmed the exteriors there. We had to do a lot of work to bring it up to date, or take it back in time. But it still does exist. But what we did was, through the interiors, we said, okay, these are the things that interest us. And we sort of brought them all together into one space, so that when we were filming him, there was always the sense of more dimension beyond him. There'd be a hallway beyond his bed. There would be a kitchen off to the side. There'd be a turn in off to his bed to the side that we didn't know where it went, but it insinuated that there was more depth and more real estate to this space. And we made it sort of like a family room, like a den that they moved this bed out into, to give it, to give him a little more, just a little bit more sort of presence in this place, with the command over the people that were working for him and so forth. And to also just give us more dimension, you know, and more light opportunity.
Yeah, can you go into, because again, interesting for me, the contrast in these scenes too. And we're talking, at least for me, about us constantly feeling that he's trapped somewhere, and that in the ranch, he feels again like he's too big for it. And San Simeon, we're watching him being sent out to the children's table. But still, in this, both of these scenes, as we see so often in the movie, you guys have visual references for him not quite being in control of his life, that the spaces are somehow dictating that to us in these really, I think, nuanced ways. So talk about the way you decorate that room too.
Well, it was meant to feel as though the bed was sort of set up just for him. So we sort of tried to imagine what would the room look like originally, and we wanted to capture the style of that era, so we used a lot of Monterey furniture that would have been around at the time, and California pottery and things like that. And it was a ranch where guests would come and go. So we sort of wanted to imagine that people had brought things and left things, or found objects in the desert. You know, we had antlers and arrowheads, which you may or may not see, but, you know, we're also telling the story. And so that was part of our story. We always like to create a backstory for the place or for the character or whatever it is. So anything to support the story, but to not steal the scene, right? So we really tried to bring all of the desert elements in. And then the last day that we were dressing, Don joined us, and we started blowing sand into the corners, you know, dust and building up the dust on the tables, because every time the screen door would be open, dust would blow in. So that sort of thing really helped. I think it really helped us out, and it helped the actor, because the thought of telling a story about a man who spends a third of the movie in bed is a challenge. It's like, oh my God, what do we do?
So in a bed in Victorville.
Exactly. So it was, we tried to just, you know, sit in what was his perspective? What did he see? So we would always look at it from what his point of view would have been.
let me ask you guys this question, because the movie is really, in a lot of ways, about a guy who's never in a space that belongs to him. We were aware of that in Victorville, or San Simeon, or David L. Selznick's office, or when he goes backstage, when he's walking across a lot at MGM. He's in so many places that don't belong to him, that I think for us, and you guys built this out so beautifully, that sort of sense of him being lost, I mean, him not being rooted, almost being bounced from room to room like a ball. Was that part of your consideration too in working on all these spaces?
I think it was. I mean, you know, we sort of started with the script and we follow the lead of the script and where it takes us. And as you read the script, you start to realize that this man has, you know, he's fighting a battle internally as well as externally. And the external is the spaces, obviously, that he's dealing with. But, you know, he's uncomfortable with so many parts of the world that he has to deal with, especially in the film industry, you know, with the Selznick's office, with the Thalberg's office, places like that, where we wanted to show them being, you know, a little more authoritarian than, for instance, the writer's rooms, where probably he felt his most comfort because he was able to be with the guys, gamble, you know, drink, do all the things that they did in those days, and complain openly about the business. You know,
even in those scenes in the writers are going with Parent, where the sales, he's still like between two people. He's constantly exactly. sort of like jammed exactly. in somewhere, or like not feeling exactly. like that there's any ownership. And again, I didn't mean to interrupt you, Don, but I just think it's
so
illustrated that the way that you guys work that out.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. And that's true, because it was sort of like a bullpen room where he was always kind of squeezed from one side or the other. And, you know, I think we just approached it by keeping it real. And, you know, just every space we wanted to keep real. And then we wanted to differentiate between the haves and the have nots. And we wanted to differentiate between the Victorville and the LA. And in LA, we wanted to show separation between the studios, you know, MGM sort of being the big dog, the royal studio and the moneymaker, and Paramount sort of, you know, it's the Avis car rental, we try harder because we're number two kind of place. You know what I mean? It's that kind of feel. So we were trying to create these different levels of, you know, both socioeconomic and also just places where he would inhabit and have to pass through day by day, you know.
But you're right, he was so uncomfortable with everything that, and I'm glad that you feel that we communicated it well enough, because he was a misfit. He was a genius, but he was such a misfit. I mean,
yeah, you know,
it was his, I didn't realize until we started researching that it was his idea to change Wizard of Oz from color. Right. Black, you know, black and white to color. I had no idea. Mm-hmm. But, you know, he just had these brilliant ideas, but he had such disdain for the system that, you know, showing, like Don was saying, showing the difference was what we were aiming for.
Again, I just feel like, and it's one of these things that we go to Fincher for, is, and then you guys are clearly part of that team, that finding these ways to tell us a story visually so we can, in a lot of ways, because so often what he does is there'll be a couple beats of silence so we can take in what's going on in these rooms and an almost uncomfortable silence. And here that silence is punctuated by Mank's almost desperate need to sort of try to take command of the situation. And even in even when he's on the street and he runs into his old friend and there's this conversation about, in effect, about Marxism, we still feel like he's trying to command, but that's not really happening.
Yeah. No, I agree. And I think that the great thing about David's films is that, you know, there are layers of information that you can take from them, and you don't always understand what you've seen until after you've seen it and it's kind of settled in on you. It's like a slow cooker, and all of a sudden you go, oh, there was so much happening in the periphery that I didn't really get, but it resonates now. Mankiewicz was an interesting character in the sense that, you know, I think in the history, he seems so simple. He seems like a simple person in many ways, and yet at the same time, there's this odd complexity to him because he's, I feel like he's struggled and tortured so much internally and also with the things that were going on outside of him that he so wanted to reach out to, but I'm not really sure he knew how. I mean, it's an interesting study on a character, I think, you know, on a human being.
I think too, again, I want you guys to really talk about this because the point is that he actually doesn't really own anything.
Right.
And he's even like catching cigarettes off other people. I mean, there's a scene that, and maybe Jan, somehow you get me that, you know, humidor that doesn't exist anymore. That thing you presented to him, it's really almost like somebody opening a vault or and there's gold bricks in it, or the scene from either Pulp Fiction or Kiss Me Deadly where the briefcase opens, it's a glow. But we're aware of the way he exists in this world of there's this economic kind of conversation going on, or this social conversation going on that you guys are expressing in visual terms that nothing belongs to him. I mean, there's nothing that belongs to him except for his ideas, except for his words. So he has to try to claim these spaces that don't belong to him. Now, again, we're in that office that's sort of teeming with, you know, basically it's like being backstage at a vaudeville act where there's a burlesque artist and these guys are, you know, one of the guys laying on the sofa and somebody else is just bored staring off in the space. And each corner of that room is, at a certain point, you think, how many corners can this room possibly have? There's so much going on in that. You guys can talk about just building that out too, because we get a lot from that scene as well at, before they go in to see Soul.
Right. That was a challenge. That we found the room that we recreated with the scripts was an actual room that we saw a reference photo of. I think it was Paramount Dawn, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But we created all of those scripts and there was a person who literally, when the ladies were typing all day and it was just ladies typing, they would bind the scripts and put them and store them onto those shelves. So, you know, we wanted to show the business of Hollywood behind the goings on of what their insanity was inside the writer's room, which they all had such disdain for.
They really did. And they really did. And you get that when you did the research. I researched over at the Academy and there was so much about that. And there was also so much about the gambling. And that was so much a part of who Mankiewicz was. And you talk about he didn't have ownership of anything. It was like everything was temporal to him in a certain way. You know, he would gamble money he didn't have, you know, paychecks he didn't have. And that was part of the lifestyle, part of the cycle, you know.
And post-depression, you know, as they're forming the Writers Guild, he was fairly well off, but he really wasn't because he kept gambling it away.
Right.
So the home where they lived was, we made it fairly modest.
Yeah,
again, and that to me feels like another place he's trapped in because he's too big for that too. I mean, that's the thing about these spaces, either he's too big for them or they overwhelm him. I mean, that's a really interesting sort of visual metaphor to be constantly playing out. Because we also get a sense that there's really no ground beneath his feet. He's just kind of wandering.
Exactly.
In some ways, he's like the poor version of, to use a Paramount movie here, Sullivan's Travels, except he's Sullivan with no money. They're going from one place to another, in effect, wearing the same suit. Not the same suit, but the same kind of suit.
Yeah.
Not the same suit. So, I mean, I just thought visually, there's a kind of, almost a kind of gallantry to the way you guys, the way he's supported and the way these ideas are played out. And I just wonder, in a case like this, and there's clearly so much going on in the script, if that becomes the excitement for you guys, well, how do we get this across? Because he is this king when he opens his mouth, and as soon as he stops talking, nothing belongs to him anymore.
Yeah, that was a challenge.
But obviously you were excited by it because you rose to the challenge clearly. What was the first thing that you saw in the script that excited you about it, Jan? If I can start with you.
Oh, wow. You know, the tribute to old Hollywood is dear to my heart. And, you know, just tackling San Simeon. I mean, when I got over the shock of Don saying, and we're going to build San Simeon, okay. And after getting over the shock of that, it was like, well, okay, how do we transmit that idea? How do we capture the essence of that in both the mayor salon is Mayer's birthday party, which is in the salon, and then translate that into the dining room, which Don brilliantly changed. That's the same room, reconfigured by Don. So that was exciting to try to create.
Thanks, Jan, for letting that out. Now you're gonna go look for it, right?
Yes.
Well, we have to give the fans something to look for.
Thank you, Jan, for your generosity. Don, what was the first thing you saw on the script that excited you about it?
First thing, well, obviously the history of Los Angeles and the film industry in Los Angeles was attractive and caught my attention immediately. But more than anything, you know, I read every script and it's the story that I have to attach to, that I have to become engaged with. And I really like this character. I was really intrigued by this character. I quite honestly didn't know that much about Herman Mankiewicz. Oh, I'll be truthful about it. I kind of knew, but it was all a little bit blindsiding me. And for many of the things that you've stated and that Jan have stated about him, within the film, I immediately went out and started reading every book that I could find on him, every book I could find on him, and started doing an immense amount of research on him, and just became intrigued by, you know, as I keep saying, this internal external torture that this guy had, that was my read on it, you know. And I think everybody has a different read on a character or on a point of a film, which I think a good film gives to an audience, different reads, different takeaways, but that was mine. And I was really attracted to wanting to do something about this person, you know?
Well, you work with Fincher for a while, and so often he's done movies about characters who are kind of unreliable narrators. But this is the first time where we feel the affection that the story has for them. Whereas right. Other times we don't know how we feel about these people. Right. Here, exactly. This is the case where the movie's kind of putting its arms around this poor soul.
Right. Well, kind of. Yeah.
I'll say kind of.
Kind of. Yeah. No, but I agree with you. I think it is putting its arms around this poor soul. And I think that everybody comes, I mean, most people come away, you know, being on his side of things, obviously. But at the same time, there's some marginal things in his character, like there are on all human beings, you know, that... Yeah, that's why I say kind of, you know. I don't think David ever walks a straight line with something. I think it's always a little bit, you know, he plays with the margins.
Yeah. But this one, again, that's why I use the word gallant, because the movie has an affection for all his foibles, and I shouldn't say foibles, for all his flaws. Because in the same way, if you read the Pauline Kael Citizen Kane book, or you read the book Mank, you can feel the same affection that people have for this guy, who was both enormously generous of spirit and incredibly self-destructive.
Right, exactly. You know, and he had a lot of empathy for, you know, social situations, at least to a certain extent.
Yes, conditions, always conditions.
Always conditions.
We're starting to get some questions here, so we've got one here right now. Let me take it from Bess, who says, I recently watched a Zoom about Aileen Barnsdall, funded billboards with political messages. How did you research the ones in Mank?
Could you read that again? I'm sorry, I missed the beginning of that.
I recently watched a Zoom about Aileen Barnsdall, who funded billboards with political messages. Mm-hmm. How did you research the ones in Mank?
Oh, okay. So, you know, the research for Upton Sinclair, I mean, it's easy to find, quite honestly. We just went to the library, I don't know if that was the Academy Library or if that was through Getty that we found that. I think she might be referencing the billboard when he's driving with his wife, probably, or maybe some of the graphic signage inside of the gala, the Republican gala. But we just took directly from what the real research was, you know. And there was an extraordinary amount of large billboards, especially on Sunset Boulevard, believe it or not. When back in the day when Sunset was like the countryside, there were these huge billboards for Upton Sinclair talking about everything from, you know, some religious references in terms of socialism to why he wants to get people working again and why it's good for the state of California. And I think there was this misguided thing about it being socialism as much as it was just sort of the times. You know, FDR was doing the New Deal, and I think it was kind of an extension of the New Deal. But in terms of the graphics, we found the exact pieces in photo reference, and then we worked from those in terms of producing them.
Well, I've got you guys here. I guess you were saying that you've done, this is kind of like a giving you a chance to sort of explore. Was it the same thing for you, Stu, Jan, finding out things you didn't really know about Mank and the period?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And Don references often that, you know, I went and bought a bunch of books about Hearst Castle, but we really got a lot more out of the real black and white photographs of the era, because we gained much more from looking at those.
Yeah. And we were making a black and white film, and we wanted to live in black and white. And the research photos, well, for Hearst Castle specifically, they taught us so much more about what the space was than the new contemporary books that document what Hearst Castle is. And I mean, I didn't even go there. I tell that to people all the time, and everybody says, no, I didn't go. I've never been there. I didn't want to go there. I was scared. I was afraid that I'm serious. I was afraid that it was so ornate and so well-crafted that I would still, to this day, be inside on that stage carving wood to make it look like San Simeon. And I knew I couldn't do that. So I didn't even go.
Right.
I just worked off of, I truly just worked off reference material and worked off of specifically some black and white reference, because again, that's the world we were going to be in. And the resolution of the photos from that day were not as good as the photos you get today. And in a certain way, it kind of helped us because, as I said to you earlier on, I think, we weren't trying to replicate. We were trying to emulate and tell for our own story. You know, this was our singular film. This was our Hearst Castle in a way. And although we want people to come away from the film saying, oh, wow, how did they do Hearst Castle? At the same time, we were serving our story in our film. And it just, to go up there, I just couldn't do it.
And we left the ping pong table out of the living room.
Left the ping pong table out. You know.
Which Hearst had.
Yeah. Oh, you made him seem a little more elegant then.
Yeah.
We tried to.
Thank you. But I mean, it's not just Orson Welles' films or that I think of when I see this. I mean, like the first time we go to San Simeon and Mank and Marion wandering through the grounds, it feels almost like rules of the game. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, there's just the sense of being lost in movies mm-hmm. That speak to what's going on here, as well as this movie having its own life. And that was clearly something you guys were doing intentionally too, wasn't it?
Well, I think so. I mean, that's more a question for David than for me, to be honest with you. I mean, for us, it was about how do we tell the story of the exterior of San Simeon as well as the interior. Okay. And, you know, for us, it was, again, just taking some of the simple elements and, you know, bringing them to a location. And we did that at Huntington Garden, and we set up in 3 or 4 different areas. And it was about telling that simple story that way, you know.
But the way you pieced it together, I love that when Mank wakes up after he's arrived from the Glendale station, he wakes up in a bed in the Getty Villa. He walks out the door in one section of Huntington. He walks through another section of Huntington. And then the burning of the stake is in Malibu at Ventura Farms. So, yeah. But it was all pieced together the way Don.
Right. And in terms of referencing other films, you know, when I first came on, I looked at a lot of films from that period. And I think I most notably looked at Sunset Boulevard too many times, mostly because we were filming at the back lot of Paramount. And I was looking at films primarily, not so much for the story they were telling or for the lighting or so forth, but mostly for what did it look like then? I really wanted to get a handle on what LA was, what the studios were, what places were, you know. I wanted to know what the real estate was like in the town, you know, at that time period. And, you know, something like Sunset Boulevard has so much that takes place around Paramount and everything, and it's changed so much. So, you know, it's interesting to see films for that reason, you know.
Well, this question you guys kind of answered already, but I should, in the spirit of symmetry, read it from Rachel. I truly thought you'd shot at the Hearst Castle, which I recognized, the Huntington Library Fountain. Those locations, but you guys just already talked about that. Mm-hmm. Go ahead, what were you going to say?
Yeah, no, we did shoot around the Huntington Garden Fountain. We shot at four different locations around Huntington, and we supplemented what is there with our own hardscaping, some balustrades. We noticed in all the research of the exterior of Hearst Castle that they have these sculpted light posts with these round globes on them. And we literally made like 24 or 30 of them, and we would take them and we put them all over Huntington so that we could just go from one place to another and film. And, you know, it was the most elegant garden grounds that we could find in Los Angeles to serve our purpose. You know, I think we shot one other piece over at an estate house in Pasadena as well.
Pasadena Princess.
Pasadena Princess, yeah. Yeah.
God, you know, as you were talking, Jan, I was just sort of thinking, and then you brought it around down to Sunset Boulevard. And that sort of sense of like romance and decay happening simultaneously, you know, and it's more alluded to than seen, although we get a sense of sand moving through that house just because you got to ventilate it somehow and there's no air conditioning in that period. And those two things kind of at war with each other, you know, this was kind of romance, but also he's also a guy who's, basically, whose time has passed, and that seems to be, to me, why he's so lost too. And so many of the objects he's picking up seem to be things that he couldn't possibly belong to him. I just find there's so many sort of visual reference points. And I guess as a kind of a final question for the both of you, is if that was the fun of it, just trying to find ways to just put things right in front of him that would trigger these things, that if we're aware of them, good, if not, all the better, because that means we're lost in the story.
Right. That's always our goal, you know, support the story, but don't distract.
Yeah.
You know, and that was the thrill of it all, I have to say, is to try to communicate it well enough that we take you to that era. We, you know, I'm always thrilled when people say they're so immersed that they, you know, if we've done our job right, they don't notice. But I'm thrilled that you noticed, actually, but...
Well, Jan and Trish Gallagher Glenn are mostly responsible for the little objects that come in, and they did such a fine job on it. But, you know, I think for both Jan and I, you know, I talked early on, my approach to films is always, you know, restraint is an important characteristic to use during the process of putting together the sets, and, you know, knowing when to bring things forward and knowing when to settle back and embrace the mundane sort of in spaces, because I think that helps balance and accentuate the things that are special. And, you know, I think that was important to all of this as well, you know.
No, you mentioned objects, and I'm going to say, I'm just aware of like, he's constantly borrowing a cigarette lighter, having somebody light a cigarette.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
For me, yeah. that becomes kind of the central metaphor of him not having anything.
Yeah. Kind of mooching in a way.
Absolutely. But that kind of romance or the vagabond that we saw in movies of that period, where you just jump on something and he would literally jump. And we see that in some ways, the movie, he seems to be jumping from one place to the next.
Yep.
And that sense of transport comes from how sort of vivid and lived in those rooms are. I mean, even at San Simeon, it doesn't seem like everything's just been unboxed as it would be, you know, in Xanadu.
Right. Exactly.
But, you know, the idea that, not this idea, but conceptually making everything feel like it belongs to somebody, but not to him.
Exactly.
Was that something that was kind of a running idea for you guys as well?
Yes, I would say so. Yeah. you know, the long walk down the hallway when he's getting thrown out. We recreated some the Art of War, and we put gladiator hats in the hallway, a collection of Roman items. And then at the end, where he's really throwing him out, we had two knights in armor facing each other. And one was a little tarnished and one was a little shiny. And it was just, you know, we like to try to do quiet little things like that just to help sell it, but not overtake it.
Well, what's fun about watching that party to me is it gives you, it could easily be overblown where we're just so aware of the opulence and you sort of the exhilaration of being able to build this thing out and to dazzle audiences with it. But instead it becomes a place that it, you feel it belongs to Hearst, that it doesn't belong to him. And again, I just think there's so much nuance in visual terms in it. Like that fireplace that's constantly going, that sort of always makes me think of like being in Hitler's headquarters or something. who's constantly feeding that fire? All these candles all the time. These are the kind of things that make us aware that this is
the first time I've heard that analogy.
I love that.
But you know, we've got who's basically the fascist of it. You know,
so absolutely. That's something that, you know, in designing those fireplaces, didn't really think about that specific person you referenced, but did think about the authoritarian part of it. You know, the size of them, the bravado of those fireplaces in that space, and their controlling factor when they were lit the whole time. You know, and I mean, I think what you were saying about going down the hallway and not having it be there, but not making something out of it where it overwhelms, harkens back to the whole approach of using restraint, you know, and coming in and bringing in decoration and applying the decoration. And then I come in and I'm like, okay, let's do this, let's do that. And Jan's like, yeah, let's move this, let's move that. And starting to be subtractive for the sake of being additive, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, it's the old Coco Chanel thing.
Yeah.
What one thing do you need to take off?
Yeah, yeah. It's that Jasper Johns thing. Take an object, do something to it, do something else to it, and then maybe come back to that same object, you know?
We have one last comment from somebody saying that dinner scene can be a standalone one-act play. Yeah. Let me thank you guys so much for doing this. I could do this, as you could tell, for a little bit.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. And thank you to the audience. We really appreciate the interest and the support. We really do. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, everybody. Take care.
Care. Okay.